The tribe was Judah, and the place was Mount Zion. It wasn't Ephraim. God chose Jerusalem and declared that is where the sanctuary ought to be built. There's an anointing in that sanctuary. Can I take it further? The Ark of the Covenant is in that sanctuary. The Holy of Holies is in that sanctuary. And where there is no sanctuary, we lose our power. I feel something happening here. Every now and then we have to become one voice in the sanctuary. And let the devil know you're not messing with my brother unless you come through me. Every now and then we've got to lay hands on each other in the sanctuary. As I heard the Bible say, don't forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, especially when you see the day approaching. I need to have at least four with me. One watching my flank to the right. One watching my flank to the left. I can take the front, but I need somebody taking the back. That's when we come together where two or three are gathered in my name. I'm in the midst of them. Have I told you touch your neighbor yet? It's coming. I got to climb out. And so he went to Bethel and Dan. And then instead of Jerusalem, he chose not only his own places of worship, but his own mode of worship. God chose the sons of Aaron alone to offer sacrifice. But he chose to be a priest himself. And he took the lowest of the people and made them priests. He did everything to destroy the power and the corroborative strength that God gives when we come together under God. You don't choose who your leader is. God chooses your leader for you. And then he bounds you together with the power of his anointing. And the devil can't get between that bond. When you choose because you have itching ears, you take anybody that will scratch it. But every now and then you need somebody that will stand up to you with the word of God and declare, you're not all you think you are. It's almost there. It's true now, because not only did he choose who, but he chose his times of worship. He ignored the 6 days of the Feast of the Tabernacle. That's what he did. The 15th day of the 7th month. And all of this relates to the numerical power that God uses with timing. I feel it here. He devised, the scripture said, a month out of his own heart. And that's why God says we ought to prove all things. We ought to prove them. Follow me as I follow Christ. The blind lead the blind, they both will fall in the ditch. I used to have problems with that. I said, now Lord, I can understand how you let the first man fall, the first blind man fall in the ditch, since he presumed to lead and knew he couldn't see. I said, how and why would you let the second blind man fall? The Lord told me after years of pondering, he said, if anybody ought to know the characteristics of blindness, it ought to be a blind man. And if you latch on to somebody and every time you look up, you broke, you into poverty. Every time you look up, your family's messed up. Every time you look up, you're confused and you're tripping and falling. You need to ask, can you see? Feel the Holy Ghost. Give somebody a high five. And I say, I need a seeing leader. That's who I need. I need somebody who's walking according to the guidance and the power of the living God. It was a sin now of schism. And it was, yes, a sin of schism. And no more than today you can find that everybody has their own conceptualization of God. And everybody promotes their own little idiosyncratic doctrine. Nobody tries to come together to understand the differences and to put together the similarities so that we can unite in power. Everybody's got their little two over here and two over there and three over there. And instead of folding some of these little places up and going somewhere where you can get blessed, you're over here protecting your little two over here and one over there. And I feel the Holy Ghost tonight, y'all. Excuse me. It was a doctrine of schisms because it was self-aggrandizing and self-promoting instead of promoting the living God. It was political in its attitude. If I can divide them, I can keep them from going back to the one center of unity in Jerusalem. It was one priesthood of Aaron shared ministry now with the priests of Jeroboam. The one ritual of divine obligation was now substituted for a variety of ceremonies of human appointment. I don't need to do something that's appointed. I need to do something that's anointed. The one feast of the tabernacles of God appointed by God became whatever they choose to make it. So now Israel has become toxic. And Israel now is bowing to every enemy that shows its face. Can I preach like I feel it? Feel it coming on now. It's a critical thing because when you don't walk according to the principles of God, your enemies can get the best of you. Whenever you're walking according to the principles of God, if something comes up where the enemy breaches the hedge, it's because you're about to get a Job experience. The enemy can't get there unless God allows him. Because if you're walking according to the principles of God, consequences don't follow you. Reward follows you. Feel something happening in here. And because reward follows you, when you're walking according to the principles of God, you cannot be denied access to the things of God when you're walking according to the principles of God. Because when you're walking with God, what follows God follows you. And if you look around and there's a whole lot of junk following you, a whole lot of confusion following you, you ought to check to see who you're walking with. Because if you're walking with God, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And so Israel now is in a state where we would ask ourselves, how can we be children of God and every little enemy come here and control us? Can I take you a little deeper before we go higher? You see, in the days of antiquity, when the nations came together and when they came together to war against each other, it was never the army of army against army. It was always gods against gods. This is why Israel opted many times for idol worship, because the God they serve never allowed himself into sensual perception. The God we serve does not allow himself to have an image. He is always outside of sensual perception, which means your connection to God has got to be by faith. It is not intellectual. It is not cerebral. It has to be by faith. Can I take it further? You can see your situation through your sensual perception, but you never see your God through your senses. You have never seen him at any time. You don't know whether he's wearing Clive Christian cologne or Bond. You have never tasted him. And the scripture says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. He was not speaking literally. He was speaking figuratively and allegorically. And that is, you get involved in the things of God and you'll find out just how palatable it is. I have never heard him audibly. He's never said, Noel. I have never heard him speak audibly, and people say, the Lord speaks to me. But when he speaks in a still, small voice. And if you say still small, then there is no sound. When the Bible says that the Spirit maketh intercession with groanings that cannot be uttered, it's not a because I just uttered that. When you have faith in God, your faith connects you to His Spirit, and His Spirit talks to your spirit, and then your spirit talks to your mind. Ah, feel it here. That's why God is outside of sensual perception. And that's why He will not allow any figures of Him to be drawn. No statues of Him. And the reason is, how can you draw a statue of an omnipresent God? What kind of shape would He have? Can I take it further? To show you now that it defies human intellect. And God is always revealed and never rationalized. You cannot recognize God, but He's got to reveal Himself to you. And notice, if you will, He chooses who He will reveal Himself to. And it's not because you're intellectually astute or cognitively superior. He'll introduce and reveal Himself to the people we least expect Him to talk to. Can I take it further? I'm going to draw this from another message, but I'm going to tell you this. It is so spiritual that He is making deposits right now that you don't even feel Him making. You have power that you don't even need yet, because the occasion has not arisen for you to make that withdrawal yet. He's got it down in there, and you don't even feel it happening in your mind. If that were not so, you could never have peace, which passes all understanding. Because when I look at my situation, and I deduce my circumstance, when I look at my bills, and look at my checkbook, I should be in a panic right now. But I have peace that passes all understanding. Because it's not intellectual peace, it's spiritual peace. For my mind says it's bad, but my faith says the God I serve only needs 24 hours. I feel like lifting Him up. I'm almost there. I'm almost there. It's a critical piece here, because in many instances we make it cerebral and we make it intelligent. But it's not intelligent or cerebral, because it's spiritual. I use an example, and I'm going to draw it tonight. When two boys were in their mother's womb, in separate mother's wombs. One was in his mother's, Mary's, womb, and the other was in his mother's, Elizabeth's, womb. They were unconscious when it comes to critical thinking, syllogistic reasoning, deductive and rationalization. They were both in separate mother's wombs. Yet when the two mothers came together, both boys in separate compartments, separated by two thin layers of cutaneous tissue, and yet when they came together, the Bible says that the boy John leapt in his mother's womb. He had revelation of who Jesus is while he was in his mother's womb. Years later, the conscious John sent word to Jesus and said, "Are you the one, or should we look for another?" The unconscious John knew who Jesus was, yet the conscious John is having a hard time trying to figure Him out. I've come to tell Mountaintop, don't ever let your mind talk you out of your revelation. Get another church coming on. Give somebody a high five. For the second time, I'm only doing it seven times. And say, neighbor, don't let your mind talk you out of what God put in your spirit. If it's in your spirit,